Hello, everybody. It is I, Christopher. I am here to read Psalm 24. But first, for anybody who does not know, I would like to share the gospel. The gospel means good news, and that means that though we were sinners, we can be forgiven of our sins, made into saints by the power of God, and enter into a relationship with God and live forever. Have eternal life. When we die, if we are saved, if we are accepting the good news of the gospel of the kingdom, we believe that Jesus was the promised Messiah. All throughout the Old Testament, God prophesied through his prophets. God, the Holy Spirit, spoke to men, and they spoke the words of God. And God spoke of his coming Messiah. He spoke of many different topics, many prophecies, but the main focus of the whole Bible is Jesus Christ, the Messiah. He was prophesied to come in Genesis. He's in every single book of the Bible. And Jesus was prophesied to come as a king, as a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek, an undying priesthood. Melchizedek is just a man who appeared, a priest who appeared, and he actually had attributes, seemed like that he was Jesus Christ, even possibly. He had no beginning and no end. Jesus has no beginning, no end. He is eternal. He is the Son of God. He is the Word of God, who was in the beginning, who was with God, and who was God. And he was the Word that became flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father. He was prophesied to come as the Son of God. He was prophesied to come through a virgin birth, and that he would be known as Emmanuel, which means God with us. He was prophesied to come to have a kingdom that will never end. Upon his shoulders, the government would rest, and that he would be known as Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He would have the Spirit of God upon him, the sevenfold Spirit of God upon him. He would, he was prophesied to come, and he did come. And when we're first born, when we're first conceived in our mother's womb, God puts a spirit in us. He forms the spirit within man. Then that spirit will go on and live forever. When we're born, we are born in sin because of the first fall, Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. They sinned against God, and that sin brought death, and death came to all. All have sinned. All have fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin are death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So whether you believe in Jesus or you don't, you will exist forever. You will have either eternal punishment or eternal life, eternal paradise, face to face with God, in relationship with God, in fellowship with God, and being one with God by his Spirit, and then face to face with Jesus when he is resurrected. Or when he's not resurrected, when he has descended from heaven and reigns upon the earth. And then when there's a new heaven and a new earth, and you'll be together forever with his family, with his children. Those who believe in him, he gave the right to become children of God. He gave them the right to be born as a saint instead of a sinner. So our first nature, when we're first born, is in sin. We cannot get away from it. No matter how hard we try, we can't do good enough works to be accepted by God, to be forgiven, because we are guilty. We have already transgressed God's law, and there needs to be someone to pay our fine, either us or someone else. And God provided that Savior, that Messiah, who would come, and that was Jesus Christ. When the time was right, he was born of a virgin, Mary, in Bethlehem, fulfilling prophecy there as well. Then he grew up as a young man, growing in grace with God and man. He never sinned against God, not once. He was the only because his father was God and his mother was Mary, he was fully man and fully God. He was the God-man. But when he was on the earth, he didn't walk as God. He set aside his deity. He did not walk in it, though he didn't forsake it. It was still part of him. In him dwelt all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. But he walked as a man, in full communion with his Father in heaven. Yeah, in full communion with God, with his Father, even though he was God too. Even in the time past, eternity past, God spent time with God, because God was the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. When God created man on the earth, he said, "Let us make man in our image." And so because God is just and holy, he will judge sin. And he sent his Messiah to bear the sin of all who would receive him as their substitute for their sins, so that they would not have to receive the punishment that they deserve. We all deserve the punishment of God. We are all guilty before him, and we're all deserving of hell, an eternity in hell, because our spirit exists forever. We're all deserving of that. Not one of us is righteous. Not one of us is good. Not one of us seeks after God. We are altogether unclean. We're altogether sinful, full of sin. And Jesus had called people to believe in him. And those people, God chose in him before the foundation of the world that they should be holy and blameless before him in love. He predestined those who he foreknew to be conformed to the image of his Son. He predestined us to adoption, to be children of God, adopted into his family. Jesus said that no one can come to me unless the Father reveals him to me, or reveals me to him. And he said, "Thank you, Father, that you have revealed these things to babes, that no one knows the Father except the one whom the Son wills to reveal him." And Paul in 2 Corinthians said that no one can say, or sorry, 1 Corinthians 12, that no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Spirit of God. So Jesus walked the earth as a man. He, at the time of his ministry, went out to the River Jordan, got baptized, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in a bodily form, like a dove, remained upon him. And then the Father spoke from heaven and said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Then he was driven out into the wilderness, to a desert, to fast for 40 days and 40 nights, where he was tempted by Satan, and he never gave in. Then he came out and he started preaching the gospel of the kingdom. He said, "Repent and believe, the kingdom of God is at hand." His government that would be upon his shoulder, his kingdom that would be, he would be the king of Israel and the king of all nations, had come. The time was fulfilled. God had sent his king of all kings, his lord of all lords, to the earth in flesh of man. Believe in him, the one whom God sent, and you will have eternal life. If you do not believe in him, you are condemned already. God testifies of his Son. God speaks of the Son as being the Messiah, the King, the Anointed One, the Prophet to come, the Priest, the Son of God. And when you don't believe that, you are calling God a liar, and you are condemned. Because we all sin, we're already condemned from the very first. And we will either face judgment in eternity in punishment, or if we receive Jesus as our Savior, we will receive eternal life. We'll be accepted, forgiven, transformed into a saint of God who trusts in God, who's led by God, who is taught by God, who is, in fellowship with God. And so Jesus went and raised up disciples. He told them to preach the same gospel that he preached, repent and believe, and to heal the sick, cast out devils, raise the dead. He was already doing that, and he told his disciples to do that. He gave them authority to cast out devils and heal all kinds of diseases, and to even raise the dead. And they did that through faith. Even before they had received the promised Holy Spirit, they were doing those miracles through faith because Jesus gave them the authority. They believed it. God confirms his word, and he brings the manifestation of his kingdom, which includes healing, deliverance, salvation, and it has authority over all things, over the demons and the works of the devil, and disease and pain and sickness. That is a benefit of knowing God. David wrote a Psalm 103 saying, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, with all that is within me. Forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases." That is a part of the kingdom message. It's a part of the gospel. The disciples went out and did that. They believed him, they followed him, they left all that they knew, and they followed Jesus and did as he did. Then time came for him to deliver himself up as a guilty man for us. He was innocent, he never sinned. Jesus was the perfect man. And then he was delivered up by the Jews. They rejected him. They called for his execution. And the Romans took him. They beat him, whipped him, had torn his flesh off his back. He was marred. And they thought that he was rejected of God and afflicted. And he bore our pain. He bore our suffering. He bore our disease upon his body. Then he was nailed to a cross by his hands and feet. It's amazing. And they mocked him and beat him. God of all creation, God who is God, was beaten by his own creation so that he could redeem some of them. Amazing. And then he died on that cross. His blood was shed for the remission of sins of all who would believe in him. God said that in the beginning there was no remission of sins without the shedding of blood, and that was what Jesus would do. He knew from the very beginning that was what would happen. When he created man in his image, and knew that he would put on the flesh of man to become man, and then die for the sins of man, and die for the punishment of man in his own body, his own blood being shed, himself taking the wrath and the punishment of sin for all who would receive him as their substitute. And he died there on that cross. His side was pierced with a Roman spear, and out flowed blood and water. He was buried in a grave where he remained for 3 days. Then he resurrected from the dead, and he was seen by all his followers and over 500 people at one time. He told his followers to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father, that he must go, that the Spirit would come, and that they would do even greater works than he did, because the Spirit would come and do it through them, than just Jesus being on the earth. God would be multiplied in all his saints, all of his believers, and would do great wonders and signs through all his who would follow him and believe in him and obey him. And that the Holy Spirit would be with them forever. God prophesied in the Old Testament that he would pour out his Spirit upon all flesh, and that he would give man a new heart, that they would no longer have a heart of stone, that he would write his laws on their heart, and they would be able to follow him and abide in him, and that their sins would be forgiven. And then Jesus ascended back to heaven. He went up, ascending into the clouds, with his body that was resurrected. It was a supernatural, glorified body. It was not a spirit, but it was a body with flesh. And he appeared in rooms that were locked, and then he appeared in different places instantly, and he ascended back to heaven to be at the right hand of the Father, where he remains for now until the time of the restoration of all things. He will come back, and when he comes back, he will bring the wrath of God upon the earth. He is going to come and bring great judgment upon all those who did not believe the gospel and received him and his forgiveness of sins and become born again by his Spirit. And Then the disciples waited in Jerusalem for 10 days, and the Holy Spirit was poured out upon them. He came like a rushing mighty wind and spread upon them, and they started to speak in tongues as a fire spreading across them, speaking in new languages that they did not know. But it was by the power of the Holy Spirit, signs that the Holy Spirit would testify of the wonders of God. They would speak in the language of those around them, and they could understand them even though they didn't speak their languages. And they even have languages that are of angels, that they would be edified and built up in their spirit, that language would be an edifying work of the Spirit of God with our spirit, strengthening us, building us up. That was part of the gift that was given, the Holy Spirit. And there's other gifts like prophecy and words of knowledge, words of wisdom, gifts of faith, gifts of working of miracles, discerning of spirits, interpretation of those tongues. You can speak a tongue and then you supernaturally interpret it. You understand it, and your own mind understands what your spirit spoke with the Spirit of God. Yeah, that's the Holy Spirit who glorifies the Son. He is a gift that is given to those who believe in Jesus to seal them for the future redemption of their bodies, that they would receive eternal life and their body would be resurrected and they would have a glorified body like Jesus. But before that happens, you would live on this earth and you would enter into the kingdom of God through faith in Jesus and be born again and made a saint of God, because your spirit becomes one with the Spirit of God. You have the life of God within you, and He teaches you and He leads you. He changes you. Your nature no longer is a sin nature, but it becomes a nature that is righteous, that is a righteousness nature, that is the righteousness of God, that through faith you would receive the righteousness of God, because Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin for us so that we could become the righteousness of Him, righteousness of God in Him, and faith in Him. That is the gospel. But if you don't receive Him, then your punishment will be, when you die, you will be cast into hell, which is a temporary place. You will be resurrected one day, and you'll be judged for the works you did on the earth, and then you will be cast into a lake of fire forever, where it is torment, and Satan, the fallen angels, will be cast there. All who did not receive the gospel, who were not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, would be cast into that lake of fire. So believe the message, receive the Lord and Savior, turn from your wicked ways and follow Him. Receive the Holy Spirit. Be baptized because of the remission of your sins. And welcome to the family. So, that's much longer than I wanted to do. I always do it. I wanted to get a short one in and then just go to reading the Psalm 24. But I, Anyway, I'll just do it the way I do it. And the timestamps are in each video that I share, so if someone wants to jump ahead just to the psalm, they can do that. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy, for your grace, for your forgiveness, for your patience, your kindness, and your goodness toward us, the sons of men, the daughters of men, making it so that we could become sons and daughters of God in fellowship with you, adopted into your family, given a new heart. Thank you, Lord. So if you have sickness or disease in your body, I would just like to speak to that and command it to be healed. Because of what Jesus did, He bore our sin on His body. He also bore our sickness and disease. And through faith, it can be made right. It can be made well. God, by the Spirit, would touch your body and heal you and deliver you from the work of the devil, from whatever happened to your body, that it would be restored and you would be free and receive the goodness of God in your body, the benefit of the kingdom to be manifested upon you. In the name of Jesus, I command that sickness or pain leave your body right now in the name of Jesus. I command that unclean spirit go from your body right now in the name of Jesus. That tormenting spirit tormenting you in your night sleep and the dreams, I command it to stop now. Leave that person now in Jesus' name. I speak life and peace over your mind, over your body, in Jesus Christ's name. Be restored even to the DNA level. Be healed right now in Jesus Christ's name. Even new body parts form in Jesus' name. Limbs grow back. Fingers, eyes open up. Blind eyes open. Deaf ears open. Be healed. Be restored right now. Hearts be healed. Kidneys be healed. Liver be restored. blood be healed. In Jesus Christ's name, blood, you function the way you're supposed to. Circulation throughout all the body, bringing oxygen to each organ with perfection. It's physiological functions be healed. Thyroid be healed right now in Jesus Christ's name. Hormones be at proper levels in the name of Jesus Christ, and whatever is preventing that, go in the name of Jesus. Leave that person right now. And testify that Jesus has healed you. Tell others what the great, good, glorious God did for you. Amen. All right, so Psalm 24. The King of Glory and His Kingdom, a Psalm of David. The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. Who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, Selah. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of Glory shall come in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of Glory shall come in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of Glory. Selah. So, until next time. But if before then you would like to reach out to me, you can reach me at the Contact Us tab on the lovesflame.com website, which directs to my other website, which has the Contact Us tab. And there's methods of contacting me if you like. And I would pray for you, and God will heal you, deliver you, provide for you. I will believe for that, and we will see it in Jesus' name. And yeah, so thanks for watching, listening. Until next time, grace, peace, and love in Jesus Christ. Bye.